think it would be helpful if.
The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
She's got the news. She talks with newsmakers. She encourages us to laugh, and she cries with us. Speaking truth to power and questioning authority daily, it's the Nicole Sandler Show.
It is, and it's a Friday. Thank God. Welcome to it. I hear it's Good Friday, but as I like to say, I thought every Friday is a Good Friday. I know. This weekend is Easter. Last week was Passover. I didn't do anything for that. I'm not going to do anything for that. You know, it's another day in America, and it's not a very happy day either. I got to tell you, this trial has been taking its toll on me and probably everybody else who's paying attention, because there's just so many times you can watch a man being murdered from different vantage points without it taking its toll on you. So we are going to recap what went on this week with Jack Rice in a little while. We'll talk to him in a bit. But first, there's all kinds of other news going on. So I want to start with some of that. I want to let you know that the phone lines are open should you care to weigh in on anything from the security breach today at the Capitol. Yeah. To, Matt Gaetz. Florida man. Oh, yeah. He is the epitome of the Florida man. He's an oaf. He's just the dregs of the earth. He's the typical Florida man. And the problem with Matt Gaetz, I mean, we always knew he was a sleazeball, right? But the more we learn about him, the more we feel we need a shower. Or I'll just speak for myself. The more I feel I need a shower. No sound. If you have no sound, okay, Gary, you got it. I hate when, you know, I look at the chats, and you know, we're suspended from YouTube. I don't even want to go there. But we are beefing up our streaming on Facebook Live, on Twitter, which is now just Twitter. Periscope has gone away. But we are streaming live on Twitter. If you're on Twitter, wave, say hi or something. We are on Twitch. You can go to twitch.tv/Nicole Sandler Show. And we got a few people there on the Twitch. Hi, Twitchers. Facebook is going. And then, of course, the Twitter that I mentioned. And we also have the audio streams. You know, this is first and foremost a radio show. I come from the world of radio, and this will always be radio, but sometimes with pictures. You know, so that's where we are right now. And screw YouTube and fuck Don Henley. Just thought I'd throw that in there. All right. I see somebody's on the line for a 612 area code. Are you in Minnesota?
Yes.
Yeah. Hi, who is this?
Roger from Minneapolis.
Hey, Roger. So how are you doing? How are things in Minneapolis today?
Well, today is a very nice day, a little breezy, very sunny, and we've got quite warm temperatures, and we're getting into seeing the buds swell on the trees. And April can be a sort of back and forth month.
Sure.
Sometimes we get big winter storms in April too, but it's nice to be here. I'm not exactly obsessed with the coverage of the Chauvin trial, although I surely hope that it goes the right way. How are you?
I'm hanging in there. I'm 5 days away from being able to hug my kid again. So for that, I'm really good. But I've got a bit of, I think, as I said, PTSD from watching George Floyd being killed from every conceivable vantage point.
Yeah, I've made a very important effort to not subject myself to that. I've suffered under the hands of police brutality in my life.
As have I.
um, I, I've already been quite shocked enough by this whole situation. Part of what motivated my call today mm-hmm. is my annoyance with the way that corporate media basically goes wall to wall with whatever the shiny bauble of the moment is.
Yeah.
And what we're being kept from having our eyes on some far more pernicious longer-term trends. There are sometimes some reasons to go wall-to-wall with a particular subject.
I agree.
But I think that the most important issue that belongs front and center in the news today isn't the particular, I mean, obviously doing something about police brutality and the treatment of
people
who are oppressed is a very important thing. But nothing could be more important, Nicole, than preventing the Republican move to subvert democracy in the state houses across the country right now.
Couldn't agree
and,
more.
And we get moved from George Floyd. Now everybody has to pay attention to what happened in the Capitol today for
yes.
a few days.
Which we'll talk about in a minute.
Can yeah. we set our priority on not having to have the threat of fascism in the future? Can we please have a democracy?
Well, that would be lovely. That would be, that's what I want. You know, and that's why, well, yesterday I had Howie Klein on. On Wednesday, I don't know if you heard it, but I'm here in Florida, and I had on a state representative who was up in Tallahassee right now. Florida is in the middle of our 60-day legislative session where they're trying to push through a bunch of these bills. That's why I had Robin Bartleman on the show on Wednesday. I mean, I try not to get too sucked into the here's the story of the moment, although I think so much is riding on what happens in your city on this trial where, you know, they need to find Derek Chauvin responsible for the murder of George Floyd. Because if not, then people everywhere, not just black people, but people who care about the rule of law, who care about justice, are going to be not happy. I don't even want to think about what will happen should this cop get off. It's important that people pay attention to what's going on there. But you're right. There, we can walk and chew gum at the same time.
Well, Nicole, don't you just know that there is a large number of the most scheming of the right-wing types that are watching this trial, hoping that Chauvin gets off and that there's a huge cataclysmic reaction nationwide that they can use to run on their paranoid platform again in 2022.
Yep.
I don't think we should regard this particular trial as pivotal. I think there's a very significant possibility that this trial will be lost. We live in a country where George Zimmerman talks about running for Congress.
Oh, God. Yeah, I know. We live in a country where Ronnie Jackson, the ne'er-do-well former White House doctor, is in Congress. And the guy from Texas, and the guy who now heads up the Texas Republican Party, is my former congressman, Alan West, who was one of the skeeviest of the worst, who had me, thrown in jail overnight because I dared to show up at something, build a town hall meeting, and to ask him a question. We are at a very precarious point. I don't think it's all about George Floyd by any way, shape, or form, but this is the case of the moment. We, as a nation, as a planet, all saw him being murdered over the course of almost 10 minutes by a police officer who just did not give a shit when people were saying, he can't breathe, he's hurting, he's not moving, and he just was impervious to it all. He was oblivious to it all. He didn't care. What the outcome of this is very important because we are all, as you know probably better than anyone being in Minneapolis, at our wit's end, and it's like a firework ready to explode. We need to tamp it down, and I don't know that it will be tamped down. Here's a perfect example. It's totally off subject, but it just shows the mindset of the nation right now. I come from a world of music and music radio. And so I still keep a foot in the music industry. And I'm on this email list where people, you know, it's ridiculous and I should get off of it. But I'm watching all these people, these music industry people freaking out about the idea of a vaccine passport. That, oh my God, if I want to go to a concert, I have to carry a vaccine passport. This is indoctrination. And, you know, stop it already. We're in the middle of a pandemic. We just want to get past it. And yet we have these mental midgets out there who think that they're above it all. And, oh, everyone else can get vaccinated, but I don't have to. And they're going to put a chip in my arm and track me in with a passport. It's like the tinfoil hat believers are just they're multiplying, and it's frightening to think that half of the nation, or almost half of the nation, voted for Donald Trump. That so many people believe this QAnon nonsense, that people are freaking out over getting a vaccine. We live in a time of disinformation that has been made palatable by the government powers. I mean, the fact that Fox is able to call itself news and spread disinformation the way they do is criminal. That's how we got to this point. We have media outlets that do nothing but spread propaganda, that make shit up, that call themselves news, and they're allowed to. So, you know, people are getting that information and thinking they're being informed when they're being lied to. That's how we got in this mess. I went off on a tangent. I'm sorry. But I think everything is related.
Well, I had the experience. I should mention I'm a professional musician. Okay. So my business has been aborted since February of last year. I also have four underlying conditions, and I'm in my early 60s now.
Hello.
I am ideally suited to get dead from this virus.
Me too, so you and me both. Right.
Totally hunkered down since mid-March of last year.
Yeah.
And on top of that, then here a couple months later, Floyd was murdered, and then we had the ensuing. Most of what happened in this town, I tell you, I witnessed it myself. It was arson from people coming in from afar,
of course,
driving unmarked pickup trucks with gas cans in the back.
Yep.
And they were a bunch of those malnourished looking white jerks that were trying to make the black population and the you know, we're very progressive.
Right. They want to spark
a
race
war. We're all out in solidarity.
The Trumpers
and so
want.
Then we had the National Guard here.
Yep.
We had an invasion. We had a lockdown of the whole town. I mean, curfews and overflying helicopters. It was crazy. And the thing is that the media just relishes this stuff.
Yeah.
They want to keep it cooking
They love it.
And they want to treat Trump like he's a president in waiting right now.
Yeah.
It all serves their damn narrative. And they try to move our attention from this to that to this to that. They think that they run the damn show. Chuck Todd thinks he is the kingmaker of the planet.
Yeah, well,
we've got some problems here. I realize I'm running off now.
That's okay. Yeah.
We've got some problems here. You
yeah,
know?
We do. We do. And you're absolutely right. The protagonists here, the people that drove in from out of town to stir up trouble, they want to start a race war. This is what they want. And the crazy religious nuts are the ones who want to bring about the rapture. So, you know, their priorities are kind of fucked, right? Their priorities are messed up. They want to cause trouble. And, you know, we're just going about our business, trying to get by day. I'm in the same boat as you are. You know, I'm a lung cancer survivor. I haven't really left this house in a year, except to go to a doctor's appointment or maybe to walk my dog. Wednesday, this coming Wednesday, will be 2 weeks post my second shot. And now the CDC says I can even travel. I'm certainly going to go hug my kid, who As of, I think, someday next week, we'll also, in Florida, they're opening up vaccines to everyone over the age of 18. So she'll be able to get one, too. And she will, because we don't play these scare tactic games. We want to be vaccinated. We want to protect ourselves as much as we can and get back to life as close to normal as possible. Unfortunately, I live in Florida where the crazies reign. And, people, you saw the images from the beach from spring break. It's not, we have a governor who just, is a science denier. That's, we need to start calling these people out for what they are. They're science deniers.
Well, my getting to hug my three daughters after more than a year day is the 24th of April.
There you go.
I'll be 2 weeks out from my second shot, and I'm looking forward to that. Meanwhile, jumping back to the matter of the voting rights, a friend of mine and I believe yours, Kathy Malloy, is of the opinion that the right-wingers are just engaging in a horrific amount of overreach, and that the pushback to this voting stuff is going to be massive, and it's going to totally blow up in their faces.
I certainly hope so. I certainly hope so. But just so you know, the propaganda machine on the right is really strong. You know, I remain on Facebook for a number of different reasons, whatever. So I have a friend of mine, an old friend from high school, and she's, you know, she seems to be with the party. She's with the program. But I was on her page the other day, and she wrote something about these laws, what they did in Georgia. And her brother got on there spewing all kinds of, it was just right-wing talking points that he obviously copied and pasted. That's the problem, the disinformation, the propaganda being perpetrated on us. And in this case, you know, when it's Fox stuff, it's by an Australian. I guess he's an American citizen now, but oh my God, there is a problem with our media and the way the media is not regulated. And, you know, I bitched about this yesterday. The Supreme Court just said, ownership rules, schmownership rules. Who needs them? One company can own in one market two network television stations. So maybe the CBS and the NBC own TV stations, plus a third television station that's not a network station, plus eight radio stations and a newspaper. Well, if that voice that owns those media properties is Sinclair Broadcasting, or is News Corp, Fox, or is Newsmax, or some other crazy right-wing entity who doesn't care about the news, but is a propagandist, we are fucked, because that's the only voice that market will hear. It is dangerous. Well, it is dangerous. And the Supreme Court ruled unanimously, what the hell, we don't need ownership limits on media. Yeah, we do. So I don't know what the answer is.
What we really need is public-supported media, and folks along those lines, be sure to contribute to Nicole's effort keep her and David covering their needs so that she can continue to bitch for all of us. It's an honor to get to share some time with you.
And
today.
You, Roger, thank you so much for calling. You're a musician. Are you in a band? What do you do? Tell me.
I'm a soloist.
You're a soloist.
I play guitar.
Ooh. Send me some music.
I play it fairly well. I sure will.
Okay, I would love to hear it. Awesome.
I will do.
Okay, thank you so much, Roger.
My name's Roger Roscoe, and so you'll know who I am when I send you some stuff.
I will look for it. Nicole@NicoleSandler.com is my email address. I read everything. Thank you, Roger. It's great talking to you, and thank you for checking in.
Thank you for being here for us.
I try. You know me. It's all out. I mean, everything is out in the open. I don't keep any secrets from you guys, so it is what it is. Thanks, Roger. I appreciate your call.
I'll keep listening.
Okay.
Bye-bye.
Take care. Bye-bye. So Roger mentioned what happened at the Capitol today, and in case you didn't hear, there was a security breach. Yeah, they took down a lot of the the fencing, with the barbed wire fencing around the Capitol. But today, at the U.S. Capitol, a guy in a car tried to drive through the barricades, and, he's dead. And, let me play for you a report here. This is from, I believe, from CNN. Let's do this. Whoops. Oh, it's somebody else is calling. Hold on a minute. Oh, David, I don't have time to take your call right now. David, my husband's calling in. David, I'll talk to you later. I don't have time to take the call right now. So anyway, here's what happened.
Heavy heart that I come here this afternoon to shed some light on the incident that occurred at the United States Capitol.
The Supplemental Guard has arrived at Calvary Gate.
At approximately 1:02 hours this afternoon, a suspect entered what we refer to as the North Barricade of the Capitol.
Yeah.
The suspect rammed his car into two of our officers and then hit the North Barricade barrier. At such time, the suspect exited the vehicle with a knife in hand.
Oh, boy.
Our officers then engaged that suspect. He did not respond to verbal commands. The suspect did start lunging toward U.S. Capitol Police officers, at which time U.S. Capitol Police officers fired upon the suspect. At this time, the suspect has been pronounced deceased. Two U.S. Capitol Police officers were transported to two different hospitals.
Yeah.
And it is with a very, very heavy heart that I announce one of our officers has succumbed to his injuries. We are not able to release any information, names, age, date of birth, or anything of that nature at this time, because we still have to notify the next of kin. I just ask that the public continue to keep U.S. Capitol Police and their families in your prayers. This has been an extremely difficult time for U.S. Capitol Police after the events of January 6th and now the events that have occurred here today. So I ask that you keep our U.S. Capitol Police family in your thoughts and prayers.
And now the flags around the Capitol have been ordered to half staff by Nancy Pelosi. The thing is, the Capitol was on lockdown. I'm sure it's been lifted by now that the danger has passed. But this is the state of things in this country. We are all at a very high stress level. It's the weekend. My advice is do something fun if you can. I know we're still in lockdown, or most of us who are responsible are staying home until we're 2 weeks past our second vaccination. Mine is Wednesday. And even then, I'll go out, but I will wear a mask and I'll stay away from people because you don't know who out there hasn't been vaccinated. What else? Jobs numbers came out today for February, and it was much better than expected. Unemployment fell from 6.2% to 6%. The economy added 916,000 jobs in March, the highest level in months. And that's about, I think it's like double what they expected. You were going to call. I'm sorry, I just don't have time. Major League Baseball moved the Okay, David, come in here a second. So Major League Baseball moved the All-Star Game out of Georgia. That is huge, you say. We don't know where they're moving it to, though.
Doesn't matter.
Just the fact that they're moving it out of Georgia because of their very suppression-y voter suppression laws. And again, the propagandists out there would have you believe, oh, this expands your right to voting. That's the gaslighting they're doing. That's what they want you to believe. Don't buy the bullshit. So the All-Star Game is moving. That is a big deal. That's a lot of money.
Well, the other thing about it is that it will motivate...
Talk loud.
The other thing about it is it will motivate other people to do similar things. If you recall, when North Carolina passed their bathroom bill, the NBA moved the All-Star Game, and then a whole bunch of other events said, fuck it, we're out of here too. So,
right.
so this is going to put pressure on Georgia.
Good. Well, as there should be. And again, you know, don't believe the propagandists. Go armed with the facts. In fact, there's a big story in the New York Times that lays out exactly what is in this voter suppression law. Now, it's been signed into law in Georgia. Do your research, do your homework so you can come back at these people who are gaslighting you. All right. In just a couple of minutes, we're going to check in with Jack Rice. our buddy Jack Rice in Minneapolis to get the latest on this on the trial that's going on. First week is in the can. It's there's a lot to talk about. So Jack Rice is coming up in just a moment. But first, a little time out. So, all right, Progressive Voices is in an ad. So while they're in commercials, hey, you know, everybody else, I made a commercial specifically for us. You ready? Yeah. sorry, it would help if I did this. All right, let's play it. Here we go. Hey, it's Nicole Sandler. Before the pandemic hit, I spent my weekends volunteering at our county's animal shelter, working with the dogs, trying to find the perfect humans to adopt them and take them home forever. Well, on March 22nd, 2020, Broward County, Florida shut it down, and I've been home ever since. In September, I bought myself a How to Paint Watercolors book, and something clicked. I quickly moved up to acrylics, and I started my creative exploration. I surprised myself with a few random paintings, and finally, when someone asked if I'd paint her cat, I thought, I'll try. I'd never done it before, but I said I'd give it a shot, and here's the result, Buddy. I posted Buddy's before and after photo online, and another friend asked if I'd paint her dog, Char. I made no promises again, but tried, and surprised us all. Well, it's now April of 2021. I've been fiddling with my acrylics for about 6 months. I still paint random pictures, but my favorite subjects are pets. Mother's Day is right around the corner, and Father's Day soon after that. Now is the perfect time to commission a pet portrait for the mother or father in your life. Custom pet portraits for human pet parents. For more information, visit NicoleSandler.com/pandemic-painting. Or shoot me an email, Nicole@NicoleSandler.com. Give the mothers and fathers in your life the most special gift imaginable, a custom pet portrait painted by me. It's the gift that'll last a lifetime. Hey, it's Nicole. All right, back on the line with us from Minneapolis is Jack Rice in his persona as a criminal defense attorney and a pundit, somebody who can weigh in on what's happening with this trial. So Jack Rice, I know you're juggling trying to keep track of this trial that's going on, and of course your own stuff. You have a case coming up today, huh?
Yeah, well, it's constant. I mean, you got to realize, I mean, part of what I do on a daily basis is I'm preparing for trial. So I have cases I'm getting ready to try. I'm a former prosecutor, mm-hmm. yes. And so I've tried a lot of cases years ago as a prosecutor. But I'm a board certified criminal law specialist. It's like 1% of all lawyers in Minnesota do what I do.
Wow.
And I try a lot of, dare I say this, murder cases and rape cases. It's just what I'm doing. And so when I have a chance to watch cases like these, I'm interested professionally, but I'm interested personally. What can I tell you? I live 10 blocks from where George Floyd died. I watched this happen just like everybody else, but I also lived in a city that was burning to the ground around me for months. And so I'm watching this like everybody else personally and professionally at the same time. And I can't help but sort of jump back and forth between how would I prosecute this guy? How would I put Derek Chauvin in a box? Versus the other side, which is sort of weird, which is because I'm a defense attorney, I can't help but look and twist and tweak a case and say, oh, look, the prosecution dropped the ball on that. How do I take advantage of that piece too? So I'm looking at it from a bunch of different angles at this point.
Gotcha. So Jack, that today wraps up the first week of the trial. Can you give us a judgment? I mean, we talked about this the other day. I listen to radio hosts with a different ear than the average layperson. I'm sure you do, as you just said, look at this differently. So how is each side doing? How's the defense doing? How's the prosecution doing?
Yeah, let's start with the prosecution. Okay. I think they're doing a very, very good job. This opened up with Jerry Blackwell, who is a really talented lawyer and talented from a big picture perspective. And they brought in multiples of their prosecutors. I've seen four so far. Mm. And they've done a very, very, very good job on this. And I think of it two ways. The approach that I've been saying is a very technical evidentiary approach that's saying, I'm going to prove this thing, I'm going to show you this piece of evidence and this and this and this. And the thing is that's great, because what you do is you hand a jury that and they can look at it intellectually and say, oh, see what this proves, see what this proves, right? But what they do is something else, and this really shows their worth right now, is what they're also showing is this really emotional, brutal side of what this has done to some of these people who had to watch this up close and personal. And the thing is what that does is that's the visceral piece of what's going on. Is it really valuable? It's not valuable from an evidentiary standpoint, but it's a kick in the face. It's a kick in the gut. And so you wrap those two, the evidence, the intellectual, this part, right? And then what you do is you then take this part right here and you tie them together. And then what you do is you drive that jury to make decisions. That is what the prosecutors have done in this case. It's been impressive to watch. I've been a little upset in terms of how they were able to get in some of it from a defense side.
Oh, really?
But at the same time, boy, does my hat go off to how they've been doing it.
Okay. So then on the other hand, how's the defense doing?
It's brutal right now. It looks like, dare I say this, you know, I grew up and understand, I'm Native American and Latino. I look more like my father, but if you really look at me, I'm Native American and Latino. My mom's last name is Estrada.
Okay.
And so we grew up with piñatas.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Well, guess what? A piñata is a pretty good description right now. The defense is getting walloped in many, many ways. But you know what, though? That doesn't surprise me. It doesn't surprise me because this isn't the strength of their case.
Right.
The strength of their case isn't the emotional brutality of what happened in the street. It's not. And it's very difficult. My problem with what I've seen so far is that they haven't been more successful or even tried very much to try to exclude a bunch of that evidence. It's not admissible. This idea of the evidence of coming of what the prosecution has brought in, that hard evidence of what it means, that comes in. To actually say, when you were shooting this video, how did you feel?
Right.
How did this make you feel? My response is, what do I care?
Right.
It's irrelevant. And it should never have come in.
Right. And the defense is the one who opened the door. Then the prosecution came back in on cross-examination and got what is possibly the most powerful moment of the trial, or certainly one of them, when this young woman who was 17 when she shot the video talked about how this has affected her whole life, her whole family, everybody she knows.
It was brutal. And you know what? I think what it did is, by connection, she felt like all of us.
Oh, yeah.
She did, because I think that when we all saw this, there were a lot of people who had that aha moment. Mm-hmm. People who are not Black. People who saw this and said, is this what it's like? Is this what it feels like to be in a place? To be in a place where this can happen to you like this? And they're fine with it.
Yeah.
And I think that it was that visceral connection. Imagine sitting in the room with that, feeling that pour out of a witness box, and you're watching it, and you're the one who has to decide.
Right.
That's extraordinarily powerful.
Right. And then, Jack Rice, so we're seeing, you know, we all saw the original video that she shot, this young woman who's now 18, but they didn't show her on camera because she was a minor when this happened. So she shot that video, and that's the one we've all seen. But there was a lot of other video, and we got to see from different vantage points. Yesterday, we saw a lot of the body cam stuff. But it's interesting, as they introduced the witnesses, we recognize, oh, that's that guy who kept talking the whole time, the mixed martial arts guy, right? Or that's the woman who kept saying, let me feel for a pulse. I'm an EMS person, right? And I found it interesting that the defense attorney at one point said, did you call him a bitch? Like, yeah. Well, at one point we saw the video of the officer when they first came upon George Floyd, and it was, you fucking this and you fucking that. And this lawyer is calling her out because she called him a bitch.
Right. Well, you know what? Absolutely. And I think that is part of what's going on here, is that the jury is going to get so familiar with this that they're starting to see this three-dimensionally.
Oh, yeah.
You can imagine what it is. Before, it was a very two-dimensional, because yes. The video we saw was that 17-year-old's, right?
Right.
But now what you're doing is you're imagining, that old man with the glasses. With the white glasses.
I was just going to mention him. You heard his voice on the tape, too, and I didn't know until he testified who that voice was coming from. I thought it was one of the other cops taunting George Floyd. Then I learned it's this man, Charles McMillan or something like that, broke down in tears, sobbing after having to relive this experience. Oh my God, if anybody had a dry eye after that or wasn't shaken to the core, then they don't have a pulse.
Well, and that's really the power of what's happening in this courtroom, is that what they're doing is they're creating a three-dimensional recreation of this event. But the difference now is, rather than hearing disconnected voices, ooh, there's Charles McMillan. There he is again.
Right.
You can hear him.
We know who he is.
There's the EMT. There's the EMT. Ooh, there's that MMA guy, and he's right over here. And you can see where everybody is.
Right.
And the difference is you feel them in a way that you would not have felt them before. And if you're in the room and you see them, that's what's starting to happen up here. And that really is part of the success that's going on with the prosecution team. The defense, on the other hand, has really had to struggle with that, because this is the weakness in their case.
Sure.
And this is the part, this is the pinata part, right? This is, bang, 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 and the candy starts dropping out. But if we think about the strengths of where the defense could go, and they are struggling, because what we just saw yesterday and today is his supervisors, those going up the chain, those who are trainers, talking about the limitations on what it is that somebody can do when it comes to using restraint or physical restraints, specifically using the knee on the back of someone's neck. And that the power of saying, when he stops struggling, you should have stopped that. You should have removed that. It's hard to get around that. I think to get to your question, though, about, so how is the defense done? Have they done anything right? A couple of things. If we look at what the prosecution has done, and they're smart about this, is they're also showing their own weaknesses.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
Their transparency is actually useful, because it's coming in anyway. You might as well take advantage of it and try to characterize it and create the narrative. And so when they were showing all those vest cams, right,
yes.
the last
yep.
couple of days,
yep.
what they were showing up close and personal was how George Floyd not only didn't cooperate, they also showed how George Floyd, and this is the part that the defense I think could exploit more uh-huh. and should, is this idea. George Floyd was saying that he couldn't breathe when he's standing outside of his own blue
right.
SUV on
yep.
his own feet.
Yep. When he was, when they were trying to put him in the back of the car. And I mentioned this yesterday, that it was disconcerting for me, because, George Floyd has been made out to be this folk hero. And now what we see is he is very human and very flawed. And my initial response was, what a whiny little bitch. He just whined at every turn. So it was almost like the boy who cried wolf, because he's in the back of the car and flailing and saying, I can't breathe in here, I'm claustrophobic. So then they put him on the floor, and his cries then didn't sound all that different than they did when he was in the car. So how are these, this is a defense point. How are the cops supposed to know the difference?
Nicole, look at you.
I know.
How are you doing now, right? What happens when you're the defense, and if you can make the argument that, so when he says he can't breathe and he's standing next to his blue SUV, is he telling you the truth?
Right.
No, he's lying.
Right.
When he falls down and he's not cooperating with the police and they have to pick him back up, is he obstructing? He is.
Yep.
When he starts, he is a big, strong guy.
Yes, he is.
And he starts fighting the police to get him in the squad car. And he fights his way. By the way, do they pull him out of the squad car and put him on the ground? Or does he kick his way out of the squad car and they have no choice to put him on the ground?
Kind of.
Because you don't want him on his feet.
Right.
So you have that problem, and this is George Floyd.
That's right.
He is not a hero.
Nope.
Meaning that he is not a caricature. He's
right.
a human being.
Exactly.
And the question isn't whether this is justifiable. We're talking from a defensive standpoint now. That you look at those issues, and if what you can do is characterize that George Floyd lied to you all the way from the edge of that SUV to when he gets across the street, falling down, talking about how he can't breathe, all of the various things, when he absolutely can, the problem is he does sound an awful lot like he does when he's on the ground.
Exactly.
But let's take this one step further. And this is where I think the defense, and this is what's critical in this case. What we have seen from his supervisor and the trainer was, notice, neither of them said it was inappropriate to put the knee on the back of the neck when he was struggling.
Right.
The question will be, and this is where the defense has to take this, they have to look at this issue and say, at this point, when George Floyd stops struggling, is it because he's now cooperating, or he's faking it,
right,
or he's waiting for them to pull back so he can jump up and cause more havoc and damage that he's been causing already, and there's all these other people around, and what are we going to do? While people are surrounding them and screaming and calling them bitch and all the other things, or fuck you and everything else,
right,
that's all there. So you if you can create that narrative to say, we thought that he was lying the whole time, because he was objectively lying the whole time.
Right.
And when he's on the ground, he continues to lie because he's a liar. That's the argument. And then when he starts to cooperate, is he really cooperating, or is he just trying to give us the sense that we are? So we pull back and he's up and now we're fighting him. And this guy's bigger and stronger than all of us. And he is.
Right.
That's
but we also saw Chauvin with his knee on George Floyd's neck. As
Absolutely.
People from the, you know, the crowd that had gathered, one of them stepped off the sidewalk. And what does Chauvin do? Pulls out his mace to point it at the crowd, at the people who are calling him out on this. So obviously he had means to protect himself. If he had removed his knee and George Floyd all of a sudden jumped up, he had the mace. He could have disarmed him. Yes.
That's the struggle, right?
Right.
I don't disagree at all. I mean, there are weaknesses in this case that
right.
the defense can't deny. I mean, as I mentioned, I'm getting ready for a trial right now, and I'm sitting out here in the next room, and I have everything laid out, and we have people in and stuff. And part of what happens in any jury trial is that you have limitations. Nothing is perfect. And you know what you have, and you're working on things like, what's your theory of the case? And literally, theories work like this. You'll say, I didn't do it.
Mm-hmm.
I did it, but I had a legal defense. I did it because the person deserved it, and you should let me go anyway.
Right.
There's a whole series of approaches.
Sure.
I mean, I hate to say it, but it's true. But then what you also have is you have to be able to say, what kind of a jury am I looking for that's going to give me that? And the problem that we have right now on the defense side is that the jury that they have, they all know about this, and in many ways they're predisposed. And I honestly believe there's pressure in that jury, and there's pressure with those people to convict in this case, because they know it's going to happen in Minneapolis if this guy walks.
And not only in Minneapolis, but let me say around the country and around the world.
Around the country, and I can tell you in the last 4 or 5 days, I have been on in Australia, parts of Europe, Britain a bunch of times, other places, talking specifically about this case and saying that, realize this case inside this courtroom really is supposed to be about one man, one police officer, and whether or not he did this thing. But the
right.
problem is that what this is really about is politics and the social dynamics of an entire swath of society who thinks they're being played by a system, and in many ways have been. So
right.
you have a very difficult place that this case is in, and a very difficult situation for the defense team in this case.
Right, exactly. And Jack Rice, excuse me, I go back, I'm thinking back 30 years, because when the Rodney King trial happened, I was in Los Angeles. I was living in LA. I worked on the biggest morning radio show in LA. We were the number one morning radio show. And our studios at KLOS were on La Cienega Boulevard, about a mile up the road from Florence and Normandy. So we were there. And I still remember as clearly as if it were yesterday when we heard the verdict is coming down. And I'm sitting in my office with one of the salespeople. Her name is Rhonda. And, you know, I looked at her. I said, if he's not guilty, all shit's going to break loose. And sure enough, the verdict comes over, and we just went, holy shit. And over the course of the next hour, everything started happening, and the fires came so close to us, they evacuated the radio station. This is what I fear. Because the evidence also supports it, we all watched this cop kill this man. I don't know how you can get past that. And so I really worry because of seeing George Floyd's behavior as he was being detained and arrested, and the whole cry wolf thing. That mm-hmm. really upset me because I thought, oh shit, he just gave the defense some good ammo here.
Yeah, it was very good ammo. I mean, again, I sat there watching that, and again, what we're saying here is, you know, Derek Chauvin's 5'9", 145 pounds.
Really?
We even had George Floyd's girlfriend talking about how big he is, how strong. He's very strong. He can breathe. Remember her saying he could breathe? He can always breathe. And my response is, okay, so this is a guy, how many times during the openings did Jerry Blackwell talk about the number? I think it was 27 times
that George said, I can't breathe.
Okay, my response is, now let's go back through them one at a time and see how many of those times he was lying.
Right.
Ugh. I'm sorry, on the defense side, this is the obligation. And what I can say is, he was. So if we know that he was, and you're guaranteed in saying objectively that he was lying to you, the problem is once you're a liar, always a liar, maybe.
Right, and how do you know the difference? That's why, that's what every mother tells her child. Don't lie, because when you need help, when it comes time that you're serious, no one's going to believe you. It's the boy who cried wolf.
By the way, you think about that, again, there was that line from that 12th juror when you were picking this up, where that juror said, if you can speak, you can breathe.
Right.
All I know is I heard George Floyd speaking and speaking and speaking and speaking. Now, if people jumped into this halfway through, they would hear and just assume that I'm all about somehow the idea that this officer can do that. No. I am so far from that place. What I am talking about here is I am talking about how you defend a case like this and how you cut it up into the pieces you cut it up into, because you're looking at it from a question of elements and how you prove a case and how, when weaknesses arise, how you exploit them. That's the nature of this process. And whether or not you can actually get that fair jury. And again, you tell me about you're on La Cienega,
right?
And you're waiting for the Rodney King verdict to come down, and you think about a case like this. And the difference between Rodney King and this case is that they were burning these cities to the ground before this case started.
Right. Just
because of this case.
Because of the case.
They know what they're capable of. And the fear is that what they're going to do is far worse than what we've already seen. And that happened all last summer. There were Black Hawk helicopters flying over my house, and there was charred remains in my back garden and in my front yard because there was so much soot and stuff falling out of the sky from burned up buildings.
Right. Oh, God. It's frightening. Everything about this case is frightening. Listening to this cop, and yesterday we also heard, because we heard, we saw the video from Derek Chauvin's body cam, we heard the audio from when he finally spoke to his sergeant, his supervisor, who was on the stand yesterday, and we heard Derek Chauvin covering his ass. He's like, well, we had to hold the guy down. He was going crazy. Wait a minute, after a while he just was silent and you still kept your knee on his neck. And he never even said that, and he didn't say, by the way, paramedics showed up and he was unresponsive and didn't have a pulse and I think he's dead. You notice he didn't go there.
What I can tell you is if I'm prosecuting this case, I'm leaning into the jury
at
the end of this thing, and I'm kind of like, okay, Do you remember that part when he's talking to his supervisor and he never bothered to mention that he actually put his knee on the back?
Yep. We had to hold him down, he said.
Yeah. He says, how long was it there again? Do you remember? Okay. Yeah. He never mentioned it once. And why do you think that is? Because I'm going to tell you why. Because he knew what he was doing.
That's right.
That was his intention. And he knew he wasn't supposed to do it. And he knew that he didn't want to tell his supervisors, because they would have said the same thing. This was all on Derek Chauvin.
Oh, yeah. I'm with you. As much as, and the fact that the prosecution introduced all this, bad character flaws about George Floyd, they had to do it. The drug use with the girlfriend. Right? So they get it out of the way so they don't leave it to the defense to all of a sudden introduce this and out of left field. Like, why didn't they tell us this? They have to show the negatives, too, but they get to introduce that evidence on their terms.
Very smart. That's absolutely critical. I've seen prosecutors make that mistake. They decide that what they want to do is they want to create their case without any holes.
Right.
When the case has holes. And the problem is I would stand up on the defense side and say, you know, it's all a great thing if you could create this storyline, but it's not true, because not only did they not tell you this, they knew specifically that it existed and they chose to hide it from you. So guess what? Here I am, ladies and gentlemen, to show you the actual truth, because I want to show you everything. Now, all of a sudden, they're backing up saying, whoa, 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 whoa. The prosecution didn't do this.
Yes.
They were very smart in introducing us, talking about opioid addiction. And I think that's very smart because you realize and you humanize this issue.
That's right.
That is a helpful, helpful thing if you do it in the right way. I it's so ironic to me, though, because I can't count the number of cases I've had where the prosecution in these cases, they demonize my clients for the very thing that they're actually holding these people up for on a daily basis now, right? The idea, it's not just that they're weak, they're parasites on society.
Oh.
And I see it all the time against my client until my client is now their client, right? So all of a sudden you find the, dare I say, hypocrisy, or at least inconsistency, that comes from the nature of a confrontational system, which is the legal system. And it's a perfect example. By the way, this case is going on for probably at least another 3 weeks.
Wow.
A lot of experts are coming in. We're going to see a lot of forensics.
Yeah, we haven't even gotten to that.
There's right. Massive fight. It's a lot coming up.
Oh, boy. And it's going to get relatively more, I don't want to use the word boring, but not quite as titillating, right? I mean, the testimony this week was astounding and emotional, and it brought us to tears and all that. Once they get into the medical examiner stuff, it's going to get very dry, isn't it?
Well, I have to tell you, there's one piece of this. The Hennepin County, that's the county where Minneapolis is located.
Right?
I've had a chance to really dig into some of this evidence, and they actually sent out a special agent from the Bureau of Criminal Apprehension from here and two FBI agents to interrogate this medical examiner, who basically said, hey, you're trying to get me to say what killed him was this other stuff. I can't say that. And they were pushing on him to try to support the prosecution's case, and he was refusing. So it's really interesting is there's a bunch of evidence.
To try to support the prosecution's case?
Yes, absolutely. They're trying to push him to say what killed George Floyd is one thing, not something else. And the forensic examiner, the medical examiner, is saying, I can't make that conclusion. That was the first medical exam. So they wanted another one. So realize the fight about this thing was the state isn't happy with that first medical exam. They weren't. They didn't like how it was laid out, what he said, and the limitations of it. So they went and got another. Now, they're both powerful, and they will have that, but the defense will have a piece of this that says, it's fascinating to me that the very expert that use on a daily basis over and over and over again gave you their best analysis, which you hold up as God every day in your courtrooms. And then when you didn't get the answer you wanted, what did you do? Well, you went somewhere else. Well, isn't that convenient? Isn't that
so fascinating? So the Hennepin County Medical Examiner did not find that it was Derek Chauvin's knee on George Floyd's neck that killed him?
Because he talked about his heart. He talked about the fentanyl in his system.
Oh,
he talked about the history and what he knew about what those could do to him in the first place. I mean, there was a perfect example when you look at the methamphetamine that was in his system, too. I mean, I understand if you're going to accept that argument that the defense is going to lay out, you're going to basically say that, you know, if Derek Chauvin wasn't there, then he would have dropped dead magically by himself
right
there on the
street. And we saw him dancing around inside the convenience store. He didn't look like he was on death's door.
I'm pretty sure he's not going to drop dead at any moment.
Yeah,
but,
no.
But like I said, come on, pinata. I'm back to the pinata. Someone's going to.
Right.
Now, falling out.
Did they call in Dr. Michael Biden? Is that the?
It's all coming. Not yet.
I mean, okay, but that's the medical examiner that they brought in to do the autopsy. I'm asking specifically him because he was the former, I guess, New York medical, and he's like the celebrity coroner, right?
Oh, well, and you know what? The thing is that it'll be interesting to see how this plays out. This is where the defense has some power. they also have, you have to realize that Derek Chauvin's supervisors, Chief Arredondo, who's the chief of Minneapolis, these guys are protecting Minneapolis.
Right.
Let's be clear. You think they're not biased? They are.
Of course.
They're biased in supporting their own department, their own chain of command, and they're going to blame whoever they can blame. So I think it's important that the defense certainly exploit that issue, and they're going to, I assume. And they're going to bring their own experts. And these guys will be hotshots, too.
Oh, yeah.
So for those of us who are sort of legal geeks and people who do this stuff on a daily basis, it's going to be interesting for those of us to watch. Maybe not as emotional for everybody else, mm-hmm. but those of the rest of us will be like, holy moly, here we go.
Wow. Okay. So let me ask you this, Jack Rice. If, you know, the defense is successful, and I thought seeing George Floyd's demeanor as they were trying to get him in custody, I thought that was very harmful for the prosecution, for you know, good for the defense. But it goes back and forth. But say they don't convict on the two murder charges and only convict on manslaughter. What kind of sentencing are we looking at?
Presumptive commit is 48 months.
Oh, God.
This city will be on fire.
Yes.
I hope it won't be, but I could imagine, because by the way, 48 months with a third off for good time?
No.
Minus the custody credit he already has.
Oh, God. Oh, God. Oh, God.
Oh, and then my response is, if I'm defending Derek Chauvin at this point, I move the court to allow him to not serve his time on electronic monitoring because the pandemic.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
I want you
God.
To think deeply about that one for a second.
Yeah, I am. That was the answer I was fearing. So they need to prove at least second degree murder or third degree murder at the.
Well, I mean, they technically could go up. They could make the argument that because of his position of authority as a police officer, this was special conditions, so they could go for something called a double upward. But I think under the circumstances, if you go down on just the manslaughter charge, I think the argument is if that were the case, so they went down on it. I think the defense has a lot of room to say, we had a lot of reasons to do what we did. A lot of these things went down a certain way. And this simply spun out slightly, despite all of those, which I think could keep those within that sentencing guidelines range. There we are.
Oh, man. Okay. Well, there's so much at stake here. This is not anymore about one man. This is about the method of policing in this country. This is about the power.
It's about more than that. It's about more than just a method of policing. What this really is about in many ways is that are the police allowed to kill black men
yes.
who are walking in the street? And can they do it with abandon? And can they do it without having any ramifications to them? And if that's the case, then you will have a massive swath of society who will simply opt out.
That's right.
And when that happens, we are going to have a very real problem in our hands.
I would hate to be a juror in this case because the weight of the world literally is on their shoulders. And I hope they all realize the importance of what they're doing here.
Right.
But some would argue that is undue pressure on them. The whole thing is just so, it's stomach churning. Anyway, Jack Rice, thank you so much for your input. I can't imagine having to go into your own trial with this going on, but thank you for taking the time out for us. And I guess we'll check in again next week and see how this thing goes.
All right, my friend, you have a good day.
You too. Thank you. Jack Rice, everybody. And, you know, I give him all the credit in the world. I don't know how he can remain so objective. And you know, to be a defense attorney. You saw, there. I could see the flaws in the case, in the prosecution's case, when it comes to the behavior of George Floyd. Where they can point, but I still could not defend Derek Chauvin for what he did. I could never, ever be a criminal defense attorney. It just wouldn't happen. And yes, Jack Rice is always a great guest. And now we taped that around noon today. It is now almost 6 o'clock. We taped it at noon because he had a case this afternoon to try. He had to go into court and defend some other possibly guilty person. I give him all the credit in the world. Better him than me. Jack Rice is the best. So we'll check in with him throughout the trial. He thinks it's going to go on at least another 3 weeks. I couldn't take it. I would have done anything to get out of being a juror, because I really do believe they have the weight of the world on their shoulders. All right. It is the weekend. If you celebrate, happy Easter. This is the weirdest fucking holiday in my book, but whatever. The resurrection? I'll go for the coloring the Easter eggs. That's more my speed. And the bunny. I like the bunnies. All right. Well, whatever you choose to do, have a wonderful weekend. Be safe. And we'll reconvene on Monday. I'm trying to think. Do I have something set for Monday? I don't know. No, I don't. All right. We'll figure out. We'll see what happens. Thanks for listening, everyone. See you Monday. Happy Easter.
Time for Nicole Sandler's What's News from NicoleSandler.com and the Progressive Voices Network.
President Biden on Thursday held his first cabinet meeting one day after unveiling his $2 trillion American Jobs Plan proposal, which seeks to invest in rebuilding America's infrastructure. The president selected five members of his cabinet to take on a special responsibility to educate the public about the plan. The five are Transportation Secretary Pete Buttigieg, Energy Secretary Jennifer Granholm, Housing and Urban Development Secretary Marcia Fudge, Labor Secretary Marty Walsh, and Commerce Secretary Gina Raimondo. White House Press Secretary Jen Psaki said that these five will be Biden's jobs cabinet. The White House unveiled Biden's infrastructure plan on Wednesday, and Biden touted it as, quote, the largest American jobs investment since World War II. Senate Minority Leader Mitch McConnell weighed in and said he would oppose the plan, quote, every step of the way. Did you expect anything different? The World Health Organization harshly criticized Europe's coronavirus response, calling the vaccine rollout unacceptably slow. This as new variants threaten to wipe out any progress made on the continent. Many European nations have been struggling to carry out effective vaccination programs as drug companies have repeatedly under-delivered on scheduled shipments. The WHO says the region has vaccinated only 10% of its population with one of a two-shot dose. Here in the U.S., the problem is different. Health experts are pleading with people to wait until after their second dose before they resume normal activities. A fourth surge, concentrated this time among young people, is looking very likely if people aren't careful. And with those surges come new restrictions, like in Ontario, where a jump in ICU admissions has forced the province to issue an emergency break shutdown beginning this weekend. But there is some encouraging news. There's a new study that tells us that the COVID-19 vaccine from Pfizer and BioNTech is effective against symptomatic COVID-19 for at least 6 months after the second dose. They did an analysis of its phase 3 study that included 927 symptomatic COVID-19 cases. The vaccine was 91.3% effective, measured 7 days through up to 6 months after the second dose. It was also 100% effective against severe disease as defined by the CDC, and 95.3% effective against severe disease as defined by the FDA. And all this with no serious safety concerns. Plus, the company said that the vaccine was 100% effective against COVID-19 cases in South Africa, where a very concerning variant has been spreading. Pfizer had previously said that their trial showed its vaccine to be 100% effective in adolescents aged 12 to 15. Well, the first week of the murder trial of the former Minneapolis police officer who killed George Floyd wraps up Friday afternoon. On Thursday, George Floyd's girlfriend, Courtney Ross, was on the stand. She described, through tears, how she and Floyd met at a Salvation Army shelter where he was working security. We also heard on Thursday from Hennepin County EMS paramedics who arrived on the scene. Derek Smith was the first to assess George Floyd's condition upon the arrival of the ambulance.
As you approached him to inspect further, were the officers still on top of him?
The officers were still on him when I approached.
And what did you do when you approached?
I was assessing the scene, running through what care maybe needed. I checked for a pulse.
And did you also check the individual, Mr. Floyd's, pupils?
I did.
And what did you determine at that point?
They were large, dilated.
So you determined that his pupils were large and dilated. What about a pulse?
Did not detect a pulse.
And what did his condition appear to be to you overall?
In lay terms, I thought he was dead.
One of the most damning bits of testimony came from former Minneapolis Police Sergeant David Plugger, Chauvin's former sergeant.
Do you have an opinion as to when the restraint of Mr. Floyd should have ended in this encounter?
Yes.
What is it?
When Mr. Floyd was no longer offering up any resistance to the officers, they could have ended their restraint.
And that was after he was handcuffed and on the ground and no longer resisting.
Correct.
And we saw Chauvin's body cam video for the first time on Thursday. We still have weeks to go of this. And if that trial isn't disturbing enough, it's now time to head down the creepy rabbit hole of Matt Gaetz as we learn new details about the Justice Department investigation of him, which concern payments he and former Seminole County tax collector Joel Greenberg made to women allegedly recruited online for sex. The New York Times reporting that investigators suspect Greenberg of initiating contact with the women through websites used to arrange dates in exchange for gifts and allowances. Greenberg was indicted last year on several federal charges, including sex trafficking. One of the women said she had sex with both men after Greenberg met her online and introduced her to Congressman Gaetz. CNN is reporting that Gaetz showed images and videos of naked women he was sleeping with, both to aides and even to fellow lawmakers in the Capitol and on the House floor. One video reportedly depicted a nude woman with a hula hoop. We've also learned that during Gaetz's first term, then House Speaker Paul Ryan's staff reportedly met with him and lectured him about behaving professionally on the House floor. Yeah, good luck with that. The New York Times is reporting that they reviewed receipts from Cash App, that's a mobile payment app, and from Apple Pay that both show payments from Gaetz and Greenberg to one of the women, and a payment from Mr. Greenberg to a second woman. The women told their friends that the payments were for sex with both men, according to two people familiar with the conversations. In encounters during 2019 and 2020, Gaetz and Greenberg instructed the women to meet at certain times and places, often at hotels around Florida, and would tell them the amount of money they were willing to pay. This, according to the messages and interviews. Gaetz has denied ever paying a woman for sex. Well, the United States Capitol Police Inspector General has issued a scathing preliminary report about the department's deficiencies leading up to the January 6th Capitol riot. Inspector General Michael Bolton, no relation, found that the department didn't send out intelligence they had that warned the planned January 6th event could become violent. Bolton also criticized the department for failing to pass along information from others, such as the now widely reported FBI Norfolk memo sent the day before that warned about potential violence and a, quote, war at the Capitol. While this is the most complete review so far into what happened before and during the insurrection, it is not the final report. There is more still to come about the incident that left five people dead and nearly 140 law enforcement officers injured. Well, Iran and world powers plan to meet Tuesday on efforts to restore the accord that would curb Tehran's nuclear program after the Trump administration pulled out and reimposed sanctions. The talks in Vienna would include separate contacts between U.S. envoys and nations taking part in the meeting, including China, France, Germany, Russia, Britain, and Iran, all according to a European Union statement. The Biden administration has said it wants to rejoin the deal known as the Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, but only when Tehran returns to full compliance with the PAC's restrictions on nuclear development. Again, the whole premise of the deal is that Iran reins in its nuclear development in exchange for relief from international sanctions. So baseball season got off to a rough start on Thursday with the opening day game in Washington between the Nationals and the New York Mets postponed after a player and others associated with the home team tested positive for COVID-19. They have not yet set a date for a new game, but the Nationals did say that out of an abundance of caution, it will not be played on Friday either. Play ball, everyone. And finally, the U.S. economy added 916,000 jobs in March, the highest level in months, as vaccine distribution and declining caseloads helped accelerate a recovery in the labor market. The unemployment rate is down from 6.2% to 6% in February. This is all encouraging, but it could all also be erased if people don't get smart and hunker down and wear masks and socially distance for just a little while longer. Please? I got the news. And that's just a bit of what's news for now. I'm Nicole Sandler. If you appreciate these reports and the Nicole Sandler Show, I hope you'll consider making a contribution. My work is 100% listener supported, and I can't do it without your help. Find out more at NicoleSandler.com, and please click on that donate button.
CIO, TTD. FL CIO on Twitter. Greg, thank you for joining us today. There is